Good night, honorable political leader, fellow MPs, senators, my brothers and sisters in the UNC, and mostly our patriots of Trinidad and Tobago, both here and abroad. We are coming closer to January 25th and local government by-elections that are going to be taking place in 5 electoral districts. And what we continue to witness is the unfolding of what I call corruption and exemption. It is nothing short of a scandal that is plaguing this country and has been plaguing the citizens of this country for almost 10 months since this government decided to take notice of the pandemic last year, March. Belated notice, I should say. They have shut the airport. They have not shut the borders. They have shut the airport. And they have left our people outside in the cold. Everything else coming in and out illegally, but the people who have a birthright and deserve to be here cannot come in because it have corruption in the exemption. Every single day, we are sitting down and witnessing the horror and the plight of our people. They are left destitute, depressed, and disowned by this incompetent and wicked PNM administration. And they haven't just abandoned our people, you know, but they engineered a whole campaign of animosity against them, fueling it by fear of this COVID pandemic. And all the people want to do is come home. So it have no room on the iguana tail for the elderly who went to seek medical attention abroad or to care for a relative or their grandchildren or even people who went to work and earn a living, because the way the government has managed this economy in the last 5 years, even in the height of a pandemic, people cannot afford to miss the opportunity to go abroad and earn a living. They have created an exemption process now unlike anything the world has ever seen. It is akin to the vesting of absolute power in the hands of a sweeping dictatorship called Stuart Young. There is corruption in the exemption, and Stuart Young has misled us about so many things, about Delcy, about his meeting with the US ambassador, something again the other day, Saddam Ketchum lying about so much things he's misled us about, you can't keep track, about the people who can't come and fix the Coast Guard vessel. Twice in 6 months, we had diplomats having to step out and say, what he is saying isn't true. I'm sure MP Charles will agree with me. He's a statesman. He would know this man is an international crisis by himself. When you have 2 diplomats in 6 months saying he's not telling the truth. And he continuing to mislead the population over and over about this so-called policy for managing the borders and keeping our citizens outside. A policy is something that is logical and has a rational basis. What we have is exemption sharing like Christmas hamper. One for me, one for you. Where whoever the minister feels should get one must get one. The minister friends and family coming in, flying out as they well want. Dog with pedigree coming in. But the average, hard-working Trinidad and Tobago citizen, like a pothung lockout and sleeping outside in the yard in the cold. It is time for us to scrap this exemption and get rid of the corruption in the exemption. As a citizen of this country, you have a right of return under international law and convention. And it is also in our local laws. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights says no one shall be arbitrarily deprived of the right to enter his own country. Black and white in the Immigration Act, a citizen of Trinidad and Tobago has a right to be admitted. But I know no right is absolute. And you have to take steps to protect the wider population, but it must be reasonable and proportionate. And it must make sense. It is arbitrary to say the very least that our countrymen and women, who the Prime Minister has talked about crying on TV in his well-known tone of arrogance and haughtiness, that they can't come back home after several months. But minister and PS and daughter who live in abroad and son who go on to study, coming in and going out as they please. People are crying out, and I want to tell you tonight, we are hearing you. Everybody's saying, well, what are the opposition doing? Well, let me tell you tonight, we are fighting for you on all fronts. We are not just here with words every Monday night. We are before the court as well. I am part of the legal team. We are judicially reviewing and we are fighting a constitutional motion seeking relief for people who are stranded abroad, that they are infringing your right to liberty, protection of the law, freedom of movement, and the right not to be exiled from your home country. I know the wheels of justice cannot turn fast enough for you, but hold strain. And in the meantime, I want to say to those who are here, who are lucky enough to be here, do not buy into this hate campaign that they want you to wage against your brothers and sisters of Trinidad and Tobago. Stand with the citizens who are crying out to come back home. The government closed the airport but leave the southwestern border wide open. The Prime Minister, I heard him speaking at a forum sometime late last year, shameless stating about how we've registered 16,000 people, 16,000 people who come here illegally, eh? He registered them, and they're all gainfully employed. Well, let me finish the sentence for you. They're gainfully employed and being exploited in jobs that your people do not have. You are presiding over a human rights crisis in relation to nationals and non-nationals alike, and you have no shame in doing so. So many of my colleagues, when they talk about this creeping dictatorship, I tell them, no, nothing is creeping. It's galloping full speed ahead. It is left unchecked by a population that is beaten into compliance because they have this COVID coming to kill you, the police coming to lock you up, and I'll talk about that just now. And any measure of dissent, they will come and buff you up and say you're unpatriotic. They unleash their social media trolls and the others in the media to talk about, or so-called media, to talk about anybody who come to highlight their distress through the on Facebook or whatever it is. All these people want us to sleep in the comfort of their own bed and not be left impoverished. I saw a man went away for medical treatment, say he needs to come back home, nobody looking after his house, his dogs. They ridicule him and insult him, but they turn around and put a dog on the flight instead of the man. Governments, this government will belittle and ridicule anybody who opposes them. It is classic dictatorial politics. People doing their job, and they go on so far to disparage and denigrate the reputations of senior members of the legal profession who are standing in court every day to defend the human rights of people, including children. And they're calling us bottom feeders. Well, if standing up in a court and defending people's rights make you a bottom feeder, tell me what stepping outside 57 times to make sure your family can make money does make you. I want to tell the government tonight, stop treating our sisters and brothers like potong and leaving them outside while everybody with pedigree flying in and out. Open the borders. Bring our people home. There is nothing preventing this government from managing the influx of persons who wish to return home. In fact, at a public hearing last week broadcast on the Parliament channel before one of the Joint Select Committees, the Chief Medical Officer and the County Medical Officer for Health in the Piarco area, because we were looking at airports authority and their abilities to manage when the borders are open. And they said with a negative PCR test as well as the exit requirements of other countries that it is very unlikely that you will have somebody contracting COVID in the airport, and it is a low risk. It is a low risk. So what you have the people locked out for? You can screen or test, isolate and quarantine as necessary. One of the cases in which that's before the court, the PS of National Minister of National Security, the same one we ask if he says he left and he can't answer up to now. Well, he put in an affidavit in that matter. He is part of the committee that has vetted all the exemptions that come in, so that is why he can't answer the question. Right? He can't answer. But he put in the affidavit that they must consider, well, the amount of quarantine facilities we have. So this is how stupid the laws are. And ineffective. PNM doesn't only make ineffective law, you know. Ineffective law and laws to help themselves. But the PNM passed a law that say, or they have a policy now, that if you test positive for COVID, you could quarantine home. But if you're coming in with a negative test, you must go in a state facility. And we don't have enough state facilities, so stay outside. That is the logic and the reasoning behind what they are doing. That is the intellectual bankruptcy of this PNM government. Because they don't care enough to find a meaningful solution for the suffering being faced by the average citizen. Them children coming home for holidays, them leaving for school, coming back in, farm workers could face winter with limited resources. They do not care. Now, instead of cussing up lawyers every day, I want them to say, produce some actual statistics. Tell us how many people have actually been infected by returning nationals. With the exception of the initial influx of the cruise ship people early in the pandemic, I can tell you it's been very low. I tried to work it out. Between November and December, it's somewhere about 5% of the total number of infections. 5%. Can you say the same about all of them who whining and jamming in Tyrico? Or who fetting up in no man's land? No. But that's just to show you how it doesn't make any sense. But you see, the narrative that the government will peddle will change depending on who stands to benefit. So in a bar, where you can have people seated socially distanced, temperature check on entry, forced to sanitize, they must not be able to have people coming, so they must lose money. But the mall could open for Christmas, and swarming with people, nobody taking note of how they're behaving or how they're socially distancing. And every time they put a question to them, and you pressure them, they will plant some story in the head of their supporters. So the new thing now is, well, it's a new strain. The new strain coming to kill everybody if we open the borders. Well, viruses evolve. I am not a doctor, but I think I have a one in biology. I have a one in biology, I don't think. I have a one in biology, and I know every year the flu virus evolves, the viruses evolve. That's what they do. Well, I want to tell the PNM government, it's time that you all evolve into some actual leaders. Evolve into leaders like what we see elsewhere in the Caribbean. Barbados and Jamaica have their borders open, lower rates of infection than we have. They didn't just bring back home the nationals, they allowed the tourism sector to open as well. Because they have what we don't have. They have leadership, they have courage, and they have compassion for their own citizens. In fact, they have shown greater compassion for the citizens than Stuart Young and Keith Rowley have shown for ours. None of the laws that have been passed by the PNM government have been effective. I read in the newspaper 10 more people walk free after being charged. People come to court 6 times in 7 months. The police never show up to prosecute the matter. Why? Because they go on private premises to arrest people. Now, I don't blame the commissioner of police. You know, he gave them a good lesson in law last year. I was impressed, quite impressed. But it does seem like the lawyers in the PNM administration know about private space versus public space. They make the poor fella apologize after he tell them and school them on constitutional law and on the law as it relates to public and private spaces. But he was right. He was quite right. These public health regulations that the AG come up with, the first statement I made, I said it wishy-washy, it half-baked, totally ineffective, and they have proven true because you cannot keep the rate of infection down. Maybe you all don't understand what how to draft laws and how to make laws. So no, just now you're going to hear that your tax dollars are going to be spent to settle claims for malicious prosecution because none of the charges standing up in court. So it had no money for road and drain. The government boss that you want to drive on the government road, force it bad. But they will have to raise revenue through property tax while wasting resources to pretend that they're doing something like charging people in the private home for having a gathering when the law doesn't prevent that. But the real problem that they have is that they insist on passing laws without parliamentary oversight. Any chance they get, and they will try to slip something past us by an order or regulation that they don't have to bring to the parliament, they will do it. And in a most frightening move, what they're doing now is taking away the special majority requirement. One, they are acting special majority because it infringes upon your rights and under the Constitution. And the next day, Farris, we have a magic wand, and all of a sudden, poof, is the whole certificate gone, and the thing is simple majority. They did it with procurement because they know we were not going to support it. And they're coming again tomorrow with another one, the evidence bill. Because you see, they want you to believe that they're tough on crime. But what they do is they got the Procurement Act to make room for corruption. So they're not tough on crime, but they have to fool you into thinking that they're doing something. They will come on later on and they will make up a big stink again about the bottom feeders and all that. But let me tell you something, we are not afraid to face you in court. When these laws are proclaimed and they start infringing upon people's rights and liberties, we will fight you in the parliament, we will fight you in the pavement, and we will fight you in the courthouse because we will not take it. My honorable political leader have court closed, and so do I. And I was honored to sit behind her as her junior when she wiped the floor with Farris's legal team when they tried to illegally interfere with the process of appointing a commissioner of police, and we will do it again. But it is important for the interest groups of this country to take note and to continue to fight with us. There's a movement afoot, especially with the procurement legislation. They can't brand everybody as a UNC and bully everybody into submission. So I want to tell you tonight, stand up, speak out, be heard, and be counted. When January 25th comes around, you have 5 good, decent people fighting in the 5 electoral districts, and I implore you to come out and cast your vote. This is not just about local government. It's not about how much garbage they pick up and how much hamper and food card they could give out. It is to send a message to the PNM that we are fed up and we will not tolerate the way that they treat the citizens of this country anymore. As I am on the topic of crime, my last issue that I want to speak about. About 2 months ago, apart from the nationals being stranded, the other aspect of crime in this country that pains me, it really pains me, is what women are going through in this country. 2 months now, we say we want non-lethal weapons. We've asked for it. The Prime Minister say, well, he need advice. Well, I don't know. Gary Sobers only giving out exemption, and I'm afraid to ask the next one for advice, except which building to rent. So we can't get the advice up to now, and we can't hear about it. The PNM Women's League, I don't hear all you. A woman was a beloved school teacher killed in Coover. A next lady attacked with a hammer in Separia. Coover lives don't matter and Separia lives don't matter to all. All the defending PNM CNC 3. That is what you all studying to do. I want to tell you all, I mean, you can't can't really expect too much from them. You know, these people have no problem with women to a golf course that need grooming and pulling off yellow sari, and that's the standard, that's the bar that they have set. So yeah, we can't have high expectations for them. But if you all want to do something, let me give you a piece of advice. Since some people in the media are doing their research in Balize House, get a copy of the election petition decision and put it there for them to read and send one for them. Contrary to all the nonsense that you all want to spew out there, let me tell you something. The UNC has followed every single legal procedure and has abided by the law of this land to ensure that elections are free and fair. We won on the point that the EBC had no power to extend the time for voting in 2015. We showed the court that the EBC had flaunted the rules. Can you imagine what would have happened if we weren't able to take that step? The court wasn't prepared to change the outcome of the election, but it was a significant ruling about what powers the EBC had and how election rules are to be applied. And the same applies to recounts. It is a legally recognized process. So before you go on TV sipping, pretending to sip coffee, but sipping Balize juice in your mug, let me tell you something. You cannot equate the exercise of legitimate legal rights to the storming of a government building. And the PNN Women's League, if you all want a battle to fight and something to do, go and ask your prime minister to get some advice and allow women to have pepper spray in this country. Go and tell your attorney general to stop propagating toxic masculinity in the parliament, talking about collect to slap and cry like a little girl and stand up in big man fight and nonsense like that, like he could fight anybody. If you all want to support, if you all, if part of your job is to, and your mandate is to support Guardian Media Limited, well, okay, come out and say that and declare your allegiance. But let me tell you something. Try to be part of the solution instead of propagating the problem. We in the UNC, we are not going to be silenced. We will fight for peace, bread, and justice. We, the only false narrative in this country that is being peddled is the ones that the PNN peddling against us, the stranded nationals who are begging to come home, and anybody who opposes them. And we will not stand for that level of dictatorship. Thank you very much, Kimmy.